So now, for today's class, we'll start with a new topic on microcontroller architecture, and in that we'll particularly look from the perspective of interfacing sensors and actuators and different kinds of microcontroller that we will need to know so that we can choose appropriate ones for the application that we are looking for. Okay, so I'm presuming for this class that you already have some exposure to the microcontroller programming and some kind of idea about how things go, and we'll build on those ideas now to kind of get to more advanced versions of microcontrollers. And one of them is TIBA board, which is ARM Cortex M4 series microcontroller board that we will take up for programming in this class. Okay, and we'll build some of the experimental understanding based on that syntax. Okay, so now for a couple of classes, we'll look at this microcontrollers, its programming details, some of the details, and I'll post a lot of material for that, and you will get to understand. Once your microcontroller boards are there with you, maybe we can run through to resolve some of the issues that you might be facing in one of the discussion classes. Okay, so that is how our journey going to be for next couple of lectures now. Okay, so let's begin. Now let me get the pointer right here. Okay, now let's move on. Okay, so for a microcontroller, you need to be having this skill to look at the microcontroller architecture and understand some of the details of the architecture. Now there can be different levels of this architecture. Okay, I'll explain you what it means. So usually, there is a lot of information that will be given in terms of what this microcontroller can do and cannot do. These are given in terms of this kind of block diagrams, or some architectural understanding will be there. Okay, so we should have that ability to get to see these block diagrams and figure out what it means for us. So we'll look at some of these data sheets of the microcontroller and then figure out. So this exercise we'll do as we go along with the different microcontrollers and some of the things that we discussed in today's class also. So typically bit accuracy of processing these calculations. It is an 8-bit microcontroller or 16-bit or 32-bit accuracy is there. Then what all interfaces are provided by this microcontroller? So if you start off with one of the base 8085 microcontroller, microprocessor actually, it was the basic computer chip to begin with, when Pentium chip came, 5586 go back in history and see it's 8085 was one of the first computers that was developed, and it's still good academic understanding purpose. It is good to see how that microcontroller really works. Okay, so some of the basic understanding of how the commands are executed in microprocessor or computer or microcontroller, there are similar ways the commands are executed. Okay, so that all we'll see based on the architecture and the block diagrams. Okay, so I'll post these data sheets of 8085, then some modern microcontrollers and our ARM Cortex. Okay, so you can compare these data sheets and see and try to make sense of some of the things. Some part of the thing that is there, we'll try to go through some of the important aspects that we look for. For example, like you know, this interfaces, in terms of interfaces, the 8085 will not have any interfaces to be provided. It will have just some kind of a ports that will be available as parallel ports or serial ports and things like that. And then one has to have some additional peripheral chips interfaced with this microprocessor to kind of make it microcontroller. So that is a basic difference to make it a hardware interface for exchange of the data, not really microcontroller. Okay, so there is a difference between the word used as a microprocessor and word used as a microcontroller. So when you have a microprocessor, like you know, your Pentium chips and other kind of a computer chips are all like you know, your microprocessors actually, and they typically will have to be interfaced with the external peripheral chips to talk to any hardware or environment or like you know, pinouts and things like that. But microcontroller will have all those peripheral also will be a part of the chip. So microcontroller chip will be a very tiny kind of a chip in which like you know, everything is there. Like you know, you have you know, your ADC, DAC interface, or like you know, you name it, whatever interfaces that microcontroller provides, that are all already there on the chip itself, and only the pinouts, terminals are out actually. Okay, but microprocessor, you'll have only the processing part on the chip, and then all the you know, control part, like or the interfaces, peripheral devices, you know, peripheral interfaces, basically there will be a part of additional chips that are provided on board. Okay, so the board will form like you know, entire like you know, control unit, but the chip by itself cannot form entire control unit by itself. Okay, so that is the difference between a microprocessor and microcontroller, and you should be aware about that. Okay, so let's move ahead for like you know, this basic architecture of 8085 system. You know, typically it is given in this kind of a form. Okay, this is like a base level architecture at you know, the elements which are there in the microcontroller. So typically you'll have this data bus indicated. This represents like a bidirectional data bus. Okay, in some places there is a unidirectional data bus. Okay, it's not bidirectional. So this arithmetic logic unit is small kind of a processing unit in which like you know, these registers can transfer data through this data bus, and the data from output of the ALU can be transferred to this you know, this other data bus. Okay, so these are like you know, typically given kind of a block diagrams. One can read through this kind of a block diagrams. Okay, what are things this microcontroller has inside? So this is not a microcontroller. This is in this case it is 8085 microprocessor kind of a chip, and it has this typically internal register arrays will be there. Okay, so this 8 number indicates that it is 8-bit register B, C, D. Some names will be given to the register. Then typically it will have a stack pointer, program counter. These are kind of some of the standard registers will be there in every microprocessor or microcontroller. And of course there will be this timing and control unit. Okay, so this is a architecture block diagram with a basic level kind of a block diagram of 8085. Nowadays, like modern microcontrollers, you don't see this kind of block diagrams. They'll give like a more you know, next layer of the block diagrams, you know, in the sense they may not give you like you know, all these registers. They'll kind of, I'll show you some of the block diagrams. I mean, you'll get clear more clarity based on that. Okay, so when you say this is address bus, like you know, typically this data bus, if you see this 8-bit data bus is there, then address bus, address buffer is there. Address bus is like you know, AD17 to AD15, okay, or address AD15 is like a 16-bit address bus is there for example for 8085 system of architecture. But like you know, these kind of a detailed specifications may not be there in the modern data sheets for modern microcontrollers. Okay, we'll just see some of the things there. So see that you know, there are no external interfaces you can see in this 8085. Okay, so that's why it is microprocessor and not microcontroller, as we saw in the definition. Okay, then like that, you know, you can read these all the things that I talked about on the last slide. Okay, there are many kind of things you can make sense about, and the instructions, when they are given for such a microcontroller, then they'll be given in terms of these registers. Okay, so say there is a move instruction. Okay, contents of say move BC. Okay, so contents of register like C are moved to register B. Like that, some kind of a commands will be given, and their explanation will be given. If you don't know the structure of this architecture, then you'll not make sense of those commands. Okay, so if this diagram is not given and I'm just giving this explanation of this command move BC, it's very difficult to kind of see what is going to happen in the system. Okay, so these architecture diagrams are kind of quite important for many microcontroller systems. Typically there'll be these registers which are indicating some kind of operation done or not done. Okay, so this is called a flag register. Okay, flag is something which you show when something is done or not done or something like that. Okay, so this flag register also has this kind of a sense of notion that it has some kind of a bits which are made 0 or 1 depending upon the operation that happens. So for example, 0 flag will be set when some result of operation is 0. Okay, so this can be used for looping operations. Say for example, if you have a variable which is decremented and when it becomes 0, this flag is automatically set, and then one can read the flag register and take the control of the loop. I need to exit this loop after that flag 0 happens there. So that is a base level, that is what happens in the microcontroller or microprocessor. Okay, so this flag register is used for many of these control commands that you typically see, if while loops. Okay, so those kind of breaking or looping or coming out of the loop or conditional kind of operation execution, that all depend upon this kind of a flag register. So flag register plays a very important role in any microcontroller. It will have it. I mean, you may not be able to see as a part of the architecture. It may not show that in modern microcontroller diagrams, but it is anyway there. So like that, there are many different kind of things that you can read through and make sense of. Okay, how this is what happens like that. Okay, so see, there is some other notes will be given, operation outside ALU, okay, such as this move command, okay, move the contents of one register to other register, that will not affect the flag, like that something will be given. Okay, so each command, okay, reference or whatever this instruction set, it is called commands or commands of microcontroller, are typically called instruction sets. Okay, these instruction sets give you the details of what that instruction does in the microcontroller, and typically while giving that details, they'll refer to the flag register is set, some bit in the flag register is set or reset, or nothing is changed, something like that will be given as part of the command instruction details. Okay, now let's come to a little more modern microcontroller. If you see the data sheet, I'll share with you the data sheet. Okay, so this if you see, it will be lot more complex microcontroller as compared to 8085. There are several, many different registers. In fact, for each of the interface, you'll have a different kind of a architecture block diagrams. Okay, so we, as a user, need not know functionality of each of the registers. We are not interested in that. What we need to understand is how these things are, and from programming perspective, how I can make use of this information that is given as a part of the architecture. Okay, that is what we are concerned with. We are not really interested in how this microcontroller is designed or how it is working inside. No, we are not interested in knowing how it is working inside. Okay, although as a curiosity, we may go into a little bit more details of some of the things, but I mean, really, it is not needed to know what I mean or how things are working like that. So something is given like, okay, if you adjust the contents of this register to this value, then this will happen. Like that, it will be given. So you just believe that it will happen. You don't need to kind of like know how it happens exactly. Okay, there are a lot more details about architecture up to the register level needs to be known to kind of really figure that out. Okay, so we are not again going to get into those details, and like no, that is not the intention of this class. Okay, so our intention is to kind of like see these block diagrams and figure out, okay, how can I program this to kind of achieve what I want to achieve with this microcontroller. Okay, so that is what we are like now looking at all these diagrams from that perspective, and generally to know what are the limits that this microcontroller can be stretched to. Okay, knowing the block diagrams, one can say, okay, oh, this cannot be possible with this microcontroller. Okay, this is absolutely like no, given the block diagrams, in reading the block diagram, you can come to that conclusion, okay, this particular thing cannot be possible, or this is up to this extent it can be possible. Okay, those kind of conclusions can be drawn very easily by looking at these architectural block diagrams and some of the data sheets of this. And in XCP100, for example, there are several interfaces and modules for enhanced functionality. Like you have digital IOs, then PWMs, then periodic interrupt timers, ADCs. Okay, these are like now kind of for a lot of modern microcontrollers, this will be definitely there. Kind of interfaces. Okay, the digital IOs will be definitely there, PWMs will be definitely there. What we are talking about is now like this series of microcontrollers which are in the class of used as a some kind of a mechatronics application. Okay, there is another class of these microcontrollers or microprocessors which are used for mobile platforms. Okay, so mobile or display applications. So there are many different series of or families of microprocessors the companies would have developed, catering to different kind of needs of application. Okay, so these are so XCP100, for example, has been designed for automobile kind of a controlling applications. Okay, so it'll have the interfaces and other kind of these modules which are like specifically needed for those kind of applications. Okay, motion control applications. Okay, so those we'll look at some of the microcontrollers or architectures of only those where like we have need for this motion control or mechatronics kind of application. Okay, so this is how like these microcontrollers will be there. And now, see, if you see at 8085, like these commands here are going to be of this kind, like what we saw, this move command, for example, to move this contents of this register. These are like basic assembly language kind of programs. Okay, so for example, here like we have this move command that we mentioned here. So they are like these are more like assembly language kind of a programs. So like the microcontrollers like XCP, you don't kind of like start writing those assembly level commands to do the programming. What you do is like you do this programming in C rather than at assembly level, and compiler. Okay, typically like there will be an the environment will be there, development environment, integrated development environment. Okay, so that environment in this XCP for a case, we have this Code Warrior kind of a software environment which will compile this C code and convert it into the assembly language, and actually carry out the operation of like dumping this assembly language code into memory of microcontroller to execute. Okay, so these all things are now done at a much higher level. Okay, so a user doesn't need to know what are the opcodes or like these assembly language commands that are used for executing your program. You just need to write your program in as if you are writing in C, and then like your job is done. So we'll get into programming aspects pretty soon. Just hold on for a while. But this is important to know. Because now the efficacy of what you are using in C program and what gets converted into assembly language lies with this Code Warrior or whatever Code Composer Studio in Diva case, and so that compiler, okay, is determining, okay, although whatever you have written in C, how faithfully it is getting converted into code that microcontroller can understand or execute very easily. Okay, why I'm saying that is because, see, in C or C++, there are, like, you know, same thing can be done many different ways, okay, and not all of those ways would have been there in the compiler to compile and, like, you know, produce the output for the assembly level program. Okay, so it may not be get compiled and nicely depend upon compiler specifications, no? It may or may not get compiled, and it may not kind of pop out also major errors. But you'll wonder, okay, why I'm in C everything looks fine, but it's still why it is not executing. Okay, if that kind of a situation comes, it's probably time to change the logic that you are using in C to some simpler kind of a logic. If you are using some kind of a complex logic, you can change it to some simpler logic and try again and see. So many times, there are no unique or straightforward answers to some of these things. Okay, oh, why it appears that I'm doing everything right in C, but somehow it is not getting executed in microcontroller. That scenario is not really uncommon in microcontroller programming. We'll come to the programming aspects sometime soon. So this is a kind of a block diagram or architecture of this XCP100 microcontroller, and here there is a memory blocks that are written, so there's a flash memory, RAM, EEPROM, it's a lot of different kinds of memories are written. Then voltage regulator, there are some kind of a pinouts and pin-ins. One can read through the data sheet clear to get understand more things, but one can see there are these some registers here, PTE. These are input output registers here. Okay, so that can exchange the data in the digital format, okay, with the outside environment. Then on this side you'll have this some ATD. This is like a enough to digital converters, some interface for analog to digital conversion. So like that you'll find, see, this is a PWM interface here, synchronous serial interfaces, scan interfaces, so these are kind of different kinds of interfaces. So this scan, for example, is control area network interface. This is like a serial communication protocol only, but only for short distance kind of a communication. So these are developed for specific applications. For example, CAN interface is developed for the automobile kind of application. Okay, German automobile manufacturers, they introduced this for the first time, and it became some kind of a standard. The way you have the serial interface UART as standard now. Okay, like that you'll find a lot of these interfaces that are produced provided by this XCP100 kind of a microcontroller. Okay, so for example, if you want to say, okay, oh look, can I have 20 kind of analog sensors interface with my microcontroller, how do you kind of answer this question? Think about this. Okay, so 20 sensors I want to which are producing analog output, I want to interface with this microcontroller. Is it possible? Okay, by looking at this diagram, you need to look at where you'll give this analog input. You'll give this analog input to the A to D converters here. Okay, so this is this is a 16 channel A to D conversion. Okay, so So this 16-bit thing is there, and then there is a 16-channel another A to D converter is there. So you know, these two are seems to be same, although they are like, you know, given some terminology different here. You see the numbers here. 16 to 0 channels are there. There are only 16 channels in this microcontroller. Okay. So what are these and what are these? There will be some small difference between these two cases. So one has to kind of see in little more detail in their thing. But there are 0 to 16 channels are there for this analog to digital converter. So I cannot interface 20 sensors. So I cannot use this microcontroller. Those kind of conclusions one can kind of draw. Okay. So if you get in this kind of confusion, okay, oh no, these are like, no, seems like 32 channels. No, but then like, no, you need to look at little more details in the data sheet, and you'll get to know that, okay, oh no, there are actually only 16 channels that can be programmed. Okay. Like that, one can see, okay, there are only 8 motors that I can run maximum through this XCP100. Okay. So there are 8 PWM channels to kind of run my 8 motors. Like that, one can kind of like, you know, conclude some of the things based on the architectural block diagrams, and then one can go in like, you know, more detailed block diagram of each of the interfaces, which I have not included here. I mean, to kind of understand, okay, how that particular interface works. So how, like, you know, what are the different registers that are controlling that interface outputs. Okay, so those kind of details will be given in that architectural diagram of each of the interfaces. And that is important to know, like, you know, from programming perspective. Okay, so when we talk about programming, like, you know, we'll deal with this in little more details. Okay, so let's move on from here. So this is another kind of important aspect to consider, that, you know, the pins may have different functioning. Okay, so pin details should be given, like, you know, which pin is connected to this pin number is connected to what, its function will be given. Okay, so this pin diagram details will be given in detail of each of the microcontrollers. So XCP100, for example, so this is a pin VSS. Okay, so if you want to find out this like, you know, this is a supply voltage. So there is no other function for this pin. Okay, but for some of the other pins, like, you know, there are some functions, like, you know, this PT5, okay, has some other functions here. Okay, so how these functions, so the pin functions can change. Okay, one can program and change the pin functions. Okay, so that is what is important concept here to know. Okay, pin is not kind of like having a fixed function all the time. That is possibility in the new modern microcontrollers. See, older microcontrollers, if you go for, there will be like no fixed pin functionality. Okay, so GPIO pin will just do only digital input output. There is no other kind of a function that that pin can do. But now these modern microcontrollers will have this possibility of pins having multiple functions. And but depending upon the package, this is like no different kinds of packages. Okay. This like, you know, low profile quad flat package, okay, or QFP, you know, that those packages are like, you know, where this how this chip is packaged, and like, you know, these pins terminals are coming out is what it says. So this LQFP 144 means it has 144 pins that are coming out of this thing. So this is like 112 LQFP, so 112 pins are there from these numbers from here to here. We'll have 112 pins that are given by this kind of a package. Okay, so each of the package, some package may be missing some pin outs. So you need to see, okay, what is the intention for you to program, and then, like, you know, you can select appropriate kind of a package for the microcontroller. Okay. So this is about, like, you know, little bit more about this XCP100. So see, we are not looking at, like, you know, all the entire information of XCP100 and then moving on to next it's impossible to do that. If you see the data sheet of XCP 100, it will be like about 1000 page data sheet. Okay, you cannot expect yourself to go through the entire data sheet and then like no, then only like no, you are qualified to go for like no higher level. No, that's not a way to understand microcontrollers. It will take humongous amount of time, and then even then like no, we'll not be sure whether we'll be able to be skilled enough to do what we want to do out of that microcontroller. So this strategy or philosophy of using this information is what we need to understand here. Okay, so see, that's why like no, we want this your background in the microcontroller domain. Any microcontroller domain is okay. I didn't say that okay you should have the syntax of some microcontroller known. No, that is not requirement for this basic requirement for this course, because this philosophy of like no, how do you kind of look for what in the is what is important, and that will come based on like no, you have some small experience that you had before in MATLAB or like no, your own kind of a microcontroller programming experience. Okay, so that experience is valuable because it gives you some kind of a philosophical understanding of things. Okay, so when you are now switching to new microcontroller, you know what to look for, okay, or what not to look for. Okay, both ways, like you know, so that is where like you know, your experience would be valuable here. And we understand some part, and then like you know, we say okay, well, this part is not understood completely, but like you know, if we need that for something, we'll kind of get into more depth of that and come back to that. Like that we should understand. So if you are able to kind of like you know, understand these architectural diagrams well, like you know, lot of things will be immediately very clear. Okay, so you can practice to go through some of these kind of diagrams of XCP 100. I'll just post these data sheets there, or like you know, your 8085 of course is very simple, but XCP 100, some of the block diagrams you can go through and understand okay, oh look, I need to set some registers to get some meaningful operation done out of this microcontroller, and this all this what commands I should look for, I can look at these register details of this microcontroller block diagrams, and from there like now I can figure that out. Okay, so you don't start reading the data sheet as if you are reading a book. No, the way to read data sheet is okay, what is your intention, what do you want to do. Okay, I say okay, well, my intention is to just program like you know some digital output or input outputs. So from that perspective, I'll look at only that interface, which is digital input output interface for this microcontroller. Okay, so that is how like you know you look for you know appropriate things in the appropriate microcontroller data sheet. Okay, and then like you know some names that will be given for these interfaces also will be different. So digital IO input output interface I say, but like you know if you see in TIVA board, it is given as general purpose input outputs. Okay, GPIO kind of terminology that is used. In XCP 100, I think there is some different terminology that I have used. Port integration module or something like that is given, PIT or something like that. Okay, so those names also will be different. Okay, so you need to look for those names, look for like you know your digital input outputs, and then like you know appropriately look for that particular interface, and then like you know you go into that detail. So you should be open in some way to see that okay, oh, this digital input output is I'm searching for, but it is not there in this. This kind of a thing may happen. Like no, I see the entire content. There is nothing written as digital input output, and there is nothing written as GPIO in one of microcontroller data sheet. Impossible. Okay, microcontroller should have some kind of a digital input output interface. So then its name you need to look at that might have been different. Okay. So this is how like you know some things may differ from one family to other family and we need to hook on to the philosophy very firmly. That philosophy is mostly same in one, like multiple, across multiple platforms, and look for things that we want to do. Okay. So we'll have this opportunity to kind of, like, you know, you already have some whatever microcontroller you have gone before through, but we'll have this opportunity to go through like little more details and actually program this ARM controller, you know, Cortex kind of a series, M4 series controller.